I'm glad you cut out. I got the sign and ignored it. Talking. Okay. All right. Now we're recording.
The word of the Most High read. I'm in Genesis 38, 1 through 7. And it came to pass at that time that Judah went down from his brethren and turned into a certain Adullamite whose name was Hiram. And Judah saw there a daughter, a certain Canaanite, whose name was Shura. And he took her and went in unto her. And she conceived and bare a son, and he called his name Ur. And she conceived again and bare a son, and she called his name Onan. And she yet again conceived, and she bare a son, and called his name Shelah. And he was at Chezib when she bare him. Verse 6. And Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn, whose name was Tamar. And Ur, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of the Most High, and the Lord slew him.
Oh, well, I would say amen, but that's what happened. Okay, so what we want to do here, what we're seeing here, is set up the lineage. Actually, we see that Judah married a Canaanite woman, a Canaanite woman. I'm emphasizing that. I'm going to say it one more time. He married a Canaanite woman. And, you know, I know it reads differently, went unto her, but she conceived three sons. So he has three sons. And the oldest son's wife is Tamar. We want to keep the characters here. That's only as a point of reference. Okay, so Judah married a Canaanite woman, and he has three sons. It says, first question is, why was Judah's judgment wrong here? And it says, read Deuteronomy 7, 1 through 6. I will do that while all of you ponder on why his, once I read this, the floor is open to why was his judgment wrong. Deuteronomy 7, 1 through 6 reads, when the Lord your God brings you into the land which you go to possess and has cast out many nations before you, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, seven nations greater and mightier than you. And when the Lord your God delivers them over to you, you shall conquer them and utterly destroy them. You shall make no covenant with them, nor show mercy to them, nor shall you make merry with them. You shall not give your daughters to their sons, nor take their daughters for your sons. For you will turn your sons away from following me to serve other gods. So the anger of the Lord will be aroused against you and destroy you suddenly. But thus you shall deal with them. You shall destroy their altars and break down their sacred pillars and cut down their wooden images and burn their carven images with fire. Now, why was Judah, who went, he went over to visit this Adullamite and saw this lady and married her and had three children with her?
He intermarried.
What was his judgment? Why was his judgment wrong?
Did he marry her?
Yes. Yeah, well, in this version, say he married her.
He married her. Mm-hmm.
Judah married her, according to this.
Okay. Disobeyed the commandment.
Oh, yeah. Who said that?
I think it was Alicia.
Alicia, that you, Sister Alicia?
No, it was me, Catherine.
Sister Catherine.
Okay.
All right, okay. So his judgment wrong because he disobeyed. I mean, it looks simple. I mean, sometimes like, oh, this is a complex answer. I need a paragraph. No. He disobeyed what God had told him to do. And don't understand because this comes afterward. Don't, you know, understand these principles went on. They were in place even before because the children of God were separated from that. They knew this. That's where the covenant came in with the circumcision and all that was identified in and showed that they were outside. So his judgment's wrong because he went and disobeyed God. Now, all he did was marry a woman. What was wrong with marrying a woman? I mean, he was in love. She probably looked good. She was right. I'm just playing, you know, just
Liz got a hand.
Listening more comments here. So we're really talking about his judgment.
This is Liz's hand up.
Yeah, I see Tina or Iman, one of the hands over.
Liz's hand was up. She had a natural hand up.
A natural hand. Okay, so Liz.
I was saying that the issue was that intermarrying with these Canaanite people will cause them to turn their hearts away from God. And that's
another fact that we see. So he disobeyed, and there was a reason for God putting these restrictions on his people. See, God doesn't restrict us just, oh, I'm God, I just want to control you. See, there's always ramifications when we don't use God's word as our guide. Iman or Tina?
I was going to say, in the words of Elder Jones, and I forgot the songwriter, he just said, I want him. Like, I want him. But Elder Jones said, he preached that sermon one time.
I remember that word.
when you make an alliance with someone from another country, you're actually weakening the country you're
wow.
with.
Wow.
So excellent. And your friend, yes, that's what's going on. So they're weakening their position, and especially with God's people, because you're bringing in outsiders and making an alliance with the world.
Oh, wow. Yes, Pastor David, that was all these points are excellent and right on point. Brother, well said. Yes, Pastor David.
Yeah, I was thinking about lines of what Jones said too, and everyone, but back, and we talked about this in marriage class with Chuck and Kathy. We don't realize we do now, thank God for the marriage class, but the power of a covenant and marriage then and now. We don't consider that now like they did then. We should, but that was a covenant. And a covenant, when you marry someone, you come in a covenant and an agreement. So it's not more than, it's more than just seeing someone, you like them, they look good, I want her. You getting ready to marry someone, you coming into covenant and agreement, and you're merging.
Yes.
You know, that's even like the word said, you go into a harlot, you become one with her. So right. You're taking, in a sense, you're taking something that's considered, when you say unclean or holy, because, you know, you're serving God, and now you're joining with someone who says, hey, I don't know your God, and you're saying, hey, well, that's okay. You ain't got to know my God. You ain't got to serve my God. I still come into covenant and agreement with you. So that's dangerous. I mean, we don't consider that today, but we should. And I think about that marriage class with Kathy. That's covenant. So when you marry someone, go into them, you're joining an agreement with them.
So you're absolutely right. So in essence, what spiritually is going on is Judah is in. I see you, Sister Lisa. I'm going to get right back to you. But Judah is actually coming in, and as the chosen of God and the separated one, he's making covenant with this woman that is not of God. So what he's actually in the spirit, he's mixing two kingdoms. He's bringing darkness into his life. Yes, Sister Alicia.
Yeah, I was just reading from the first verse when he stepped out of Judah. He knew he was getting ready to do wrong because he left out of Judah.
He was creeping.
To go, you know, to the juke joint in the next town.
Creeping.
So he was getting ready to do some dirt. He had to step away from the brethren because they would have talked him out of it.
And
there's something for that too, because we look at what kind of compromise do modern day believers make based on that principle. We've sort of touched on that. You're right, because it would be easier for me if I wanted to do dirt. I got to get out of Fayetteville where I won't run into any of the elders or the elders' wife or any of the members of the congregation. I got to go a long way. You know, I'm just using that as an example, not that I will. But you're right. So even by the way you're actually saying we have to watch where we physically position ourselves. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If I would listen to your, and I agree with it, because he actually went there. I'm not saying necessarily he went there for the woman, but he went to see a friend, because they say he had a friend. This guy later talked about the guy who went down to Dolomite. It was his friend. So he's already dabbling with the uncircumcised.
I want to say, I don't know who that said that, but by, I think with Pastor Dave, about the joining of two kingdoms. And
right.
One was righteous and one was unrighteous. But what the Israelites need to have understand that, they was a people chosen by God, for God, for his glory. And so when you bringing in, trying to bring in, well, like he stepped away from the brethren, like Sister Alicia said, when you bringing in an unholy thing to a holy thing, it's going to corrupt it, because darkness and light cannot dwell what? Together. So we had to understand that what Judah did, that's why he had to step away from the brothers. That's why you got to go somewhere where you think nobody don't know you. But the thing that we have to understand, even to this day, that the Most High, he sees all, he knows all. He knew exactly where Judah was, what Judah was going to do. When he brought in that alliance, whoever said that, that just rung in my spirit. He brought in another kingdom which was not purpose for the purpose of God.
Right.
Sound like who that was we talked about a month ago. Samson.
Right. And what we have to understand, just looking at this, because I think we sort of covered, you know, what kind of compromise do modern day believers make based on this principle? And understand, because we get it reduced, oh, this woman is no good, or that man is no good for you. See, it really goes beyond that. We got to understand, what kingdom does this person represent? We are responsible to ascertain that. Because if we do not, and do not, you know, confirm that we are from the same kingdom, I'm not saying we got to agree totally on everything, but there's certain things that's non-negotiable.
That's true.
You know, marrying an unbeliever, and you know that, that's unacceptable. We're compromised. And as Elder John pointed out, we're weak in the kingdom. Remember, I talk about what Satan always wants to do is to weaken the kingdom, because he can't not destroy it. He can't make it ineffective, but he can affect us till we make the kingdom ineffective. And I think he's running up a pretty good score on us on the in the natural against what's going on in the church and the degree of compromise. Any other comments before we move to number two? All right. Thank you. Okay, Chuck and or Miss Kathy.
Yeah, not only, they had three sons. So now those sons are poised to go against the word of God. Just like you all were saying, combining two kingdoms, well, those three boys are now poised to build their household against the word of God.
Oh, yeah, that's an excellent point there, Elder Moore. Look at that, because you see the first one, in verse 6, it actually said that the firstborn, he was wicked, and God just took him out. I mean, it didn't get into specifics. So you're right. So when you merge that kingdom, that's offspring from that kingdom, in the natural and in the spirit. In the natural and in the spirit. And like I said, they already predisposed, you know, they in this divided situation, who knows, you know, without getting the detail, hopefully we see the principle that can be created by this, is the child is not guaranteed to be exposed to righteousness all the time.
Wow.
They're gonna be equally, depending on who they go to, which parent has the greatest influence. And we see right now that first one, he was so wicked, God just took him off the face of the earth. You got to go.
So can we say that, and this is a question, I guess, so we can say that this is where perhaps one of the areas where the people of God began to, when he came into that Canaanite, can we say that this is where sometimes we as the people of God begin to choose their God instead of staying with the true and living God?
Well, it may not go to the degree and
influence.
It may not even be that. The thing is, whether, you know, for all Judah may have stayed the rest of what he did, because I understand he used bad judgment to get in a relationship with unrighteousness.
Mm.
He didn't have to submit and become unrighteous in and of itself and follow her God. Basile is, I think the Elder Martin and maybe Pastor Dave were talking about, when you enter that covenant with righteousness and unrighteousness, you know, nothing good is going to, it's going to be a mutation comes out of that. It's going to be ungodly. It can't help but be ungodly. So you don't think like the woman don't have to seduce him over to worship her gods. And we talked about Solomon. He went all the way over there. But understand that Satan, he don't have to do everything. And God, I get all these analogies, but we'll get it in. Because this analogy that me and Brother Tony Johnson used way back in the day. One of the things about those of us in the military had to go out and people that fire a weapon know when you zero a weapon for a point, you know, 25 meters, 250 meters away. Okay, you have your sights aligned. You can think of the sight straight pointing, right? Where you look is where the round is going to go, okay? That means staying within God's order. Now, on that rifle, if that sight is off to the left or the right, that round is going to go the way you are looking. Your sights are not. So when we don't use God's word, that round will not go straight. Our lives will not go straight. The results would not be in line with God. And guess what? The further from the barrel, that power source that it goes, the more off course that round goes.
Good word. Good word.
The further we go away from God, the more off course we are. So you see right now, he went down there, as Miss Alicia pointed out, the, you know, I guess in his buddy, but who knows what else he's doing, because he ran a woman. So he had to have some proof. You just don't, oh, well, I'm just going away for a while. And by the way, I didn't got married and blah. No, no. He had other intentions, obviously, about what went on. And now we see that it's starting a trajectory that's off. He's off the mark. And as Elder Mark pointed out, now his sons are off the mark, because one's already dead. So right now we can look at Genesis 38:14-17. Now let me read. We stopped at 7, right? Did we stop at 7? I stopped at 7, I think.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
I'm going to read from 8 to 13. So we read in Genesis 8 to 13 to fill in the blanks here. And Judah said to Onan, go to your brother's wife, marry her, and raise up an heir for your brothers. Now, the older brother is dead. Now, Judah told his second-born son to go and marry his wife, who's tradition. So go to her and raise an heir for your brother. Now, understand, he wanted his second son to take his first son's wife as his wife to raise an heir, but the heir would have been for the oldest son, because he had the birthright. So he's going in as a surrogate, you know, to be ensure that the firstborn of the second generation would be entitled to the birthright. Verse 9 said, but Onan knew that the heir would not be his. See, they all, like, that was Mark pointed out, they all jacked up. He knew that the heir would not be his, and it came to pass when he went, and no kids around. Hopefully they won't get, but when it came to pass, when he went to his brother's wife, I'm in verse 9, that he admitted on the ground lest he should give an heir to his brother. In other words, he went unto the woman sexually, but he didn't fully consummate the act. He did nothing to impregnate her. You know, and I don't want to get graphic, say he admitted on the ground. So I'm not even going to go into details with that, but just understand he did do what he was supposed to do. The point is not so much, and I heard this used for justification for other things. The thing is, he didn't do what he was supposed to do. The physical act wasn't what it was. Spiritually, he had a responsibility to fill in and do first what his father had told him to do, and really what God would have him to do. And second, his responsibility to fully take his brother's wife as his wife to ensure that the family goes on. But he didn't do that. The physical act is, you know, it's disgusting. We can talk about it. I don't know if anybody heard where that goes, but that's not even focused on that. The thing was, he was disobedient and didn't do what he was supposed to do, because he didn't want to make a child that he wouldn't benefit from. He didn't want to carry on his brother's lineage. He didn't want to create an heir that would be the firstborn of the next generation and for his brother to get credit for what he did. So he just didn't, well, he did
spill the seed.
Bible said, yes. Verse 10 says, and the thing he did displeased the Lord, therefore he killed him also. Mm-hmm. And we got to talk about it was the spiritual ramification of what he did, not the physical act.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not endorsing the physical act, ladies. I don't even want to touch that. But what he did, because he wasn't obedient, that goes back to what Elder Marsh said. Now you done mix these two kingdoms, and now you got people that are either confused or they got these options. I can do right or I can do wrong. Well, I ain't gonna do this. Personally, you can probably think my brother wasn't right. I ain't gonna be right. I ain't gonna fill in for this fool. Yeah, he shouldn't have been a fool. God killed him, so he gone. I'm living for myself. I'm gonna go halfway through this. I'm gonna do part of what I need to do, but I'm not gonna complete this because I don't want to create a heritage that my brother would get credit for. So I'm gonna be rebellious and wicked. And do just enough of this to appease my father and to start something, oh Lord, that I'm not going to finish. See, that I think was the principle. He started something that he would not finish. And I'm not talking about the act. His was his responsibility to produce an heir. He did not. Had the opportunity to do it. So God killed him. Then Judah said to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow in your father's house until my son, this is the last son, Shelah, is grown. For he said, lest he also do die like his brothers. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's home. Now in the process of time, the daughter of Shelah, Judah's wife, died. And Judah was comforted and went up to the sheep shearers in Timnah. He and his friend Howard, this is for the Adamite, he back with the same buddy that he was creeping with before, Mr. Leach. Now we're going to look at first. So we see what has happened right here is second son didn't follow the ways of, didn't follow his father's command or do what he would uphold his responsibilities to the family. So he's gone. Now Judah has got Tamar on hold. She's a widow. You're going to be on hold till the third son grow up. And then we're going to, you know, try this again. So that's where we are. So in the midst of the time, while they're waiting for time to pass, the daughter passed, and now he's gone. He's leaving again where the sheep shears are. Now, if I would, somebody, let's pick this up with 14. 14 through 17. Genesis 38, 14 through 17.
Mm-hmm. So she took off her widow garment, covered herself with a veil, and wrapped herself and sat in the open place, and which was the way to Timnah, for she saw that Shelah was grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot, because she had covered her face. Then he turned to her by the way and said, please, let me come into you. For he did not know that she was the daughter-in-law. So she said, what will you give me that you may come into me? And he said, I will send a young goat and the flock. So she said, will you give me a pledge till you send it?
All right. Now, I didn't read 13, but Tamar became aware that Judah was getting ready to go out of town again to the sheep shear. And she did not, you see the action that she took. Now we're going to delve into the next question here. The question on what Elder John just read and fill in the blank. Who was the blame for this interaction between Judah and Tamar? She dressed up as a harlot, went along the way, knowing he was coming that way, took off her widow clothes, dressed up, and positioned herself by the way that she knew Judah was coming. And Judah went at her, and he's propositioned her. Who do we think is at blame for this interaction? I'm silent. Catherine. Oh, I'm sorry, Elder John.
I said both.
Okay, you said both, okay.
Yes.
That's good. I can understand both. Sister Alicia, with your hand still up? Elder John says both? Come on now. Some of y'all be mute. I know y'all sucking it in, but y'all got to have a few.
I would say just he's the blame.
Oh, okay. We got two both and we got a he was the blame.
I'm going to agree with Pastor Dave.
Okay. That's someone else. Okay. Come on, a bunch of y'all. Yes.
I'm saying that he was out of position. He was just not in the right place.
So he's the blame. Okay. All right, Sister Chrissy.
I'd say both. Because
okay, Tina. Tina, hold on, Sister Chrissy. You're unmuted. Where is she?
I'm gonna go with Judah
too. Who is that?
I'm gonna go with Judah.
Judah, okay. Tina, what did you say? You said he was out of place.
I say both of them, cause.
Okay, all right. I'm not saying that. Chuck and Kathy.
Yeah, I think both, cause she played.
Just vote for right now, Chuck and Kathy.
Oh, Kathy's saying both.
Chuck and or Kathy?
Go with Judah.
Judah, okay, Miss Alicia.
I think the man was at fault because the woman didn't have much status back then. So she just, you know, she was at the whim of the men folks.
Oh, okay. All right. I understand he just went through it. Well, yeah, because that's a good question. And I can understand both sides of it, but I'm going to elevate it here. Well, not elevated, not like I have it right. I can understand where they said both, but let's look at the events. So Judah's going back to the sheep shearer to comfort himself after this, okay? Leaving again. She finds out that Tamar found out. So she dressed up, took off her widow clothes and
he dressed did it
as a harlot and went and positioned herself there. Now, this might sound strange coming from a male. Just because a woman dressed a certain way or may send out what the young people said, certain vibes, that doesn't make the man have to respond. I don't fault her.
Damn.
That's me. Now, I'm not saying I'm right, but understand that she only gave him an opportunity.
I got a question, Pastor.
And he failed to do, he's married. He failed to do what he is supposed to. He's supposed to be going to see the sheep shears up there. He's supposed to be conducting business. He with his buddy. And she put herself along the way, and I, you know, that's me. I know others may have a debate, and we're going to open up for a few minutes because I'm not going to set myself up as right. But he could have kept going. If he kept his mind on what he said he was going to do, he should have went and did that and stopped adding on.
But she set him up.
But if a woman wanted
she come dressed like no widow. She came dressed like a harlot. She
would
look like a
hoochie
mouth.
I was
saying
that. Yeah.
It was, she enticed him.
Well, he was
yes,
wrong.
She did. Yes, okay, she did. So that's an excuse.
Yeah.
She took off, let me read 14. She took off her winter clothes, covered herself with a veil, wrapped herself and sat in an open way.
I had some time. Emma,
and for she saw that Shelah was grown and hadn't been given to her. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a harlot because she had covered. Then he turned to her by the way and said, please, he propositioned her.
Yeah.
He may have
propositioned her, but
there it is.
She let him put it right here.
Yes, I told you it would be a good study.
Okay, so the Lord has the floor. So the Lord.
Everybody hand up, baby.
Yeah, I know. I like this. Sister Lauren.
So can I read out of my Bible?
Yeah, absolutely.
The New Spirit-Filled Life Bible.
Uh-huh.
Okay, let me get back to where we were.
And then I'm going across. Sister Chrissy, you are next, and then Sister Josette.
Genesis 38. Bear with me, please. So my Bible says, starting at verse 14, Tamar was aware that Shelah had grown up, but no arrangements had been made for her to come and marry him. So she changed out. So she changed out of her widow clothing and covered herself with a veil to disguise herself, premeditated. Mm-hmm. Then she sat beside the road at the entrance to the village.
I think that was okay, I lost you there. Wait a minute, I can't hear.
It's a premeditated.
I got my hand ready, Pat.
It was premeditated.
We knew it was premeditated.
Because she knew what she was doing. She it said she tried to get out of her widow clothing and covered herself with the veil to disguise.
Same thing.
Right.
Herself. Okay. Then she sat beside the road at the entrance to the village. She disguised herself. Wasn't that premeditation?
Let me get somebody else. Sister Prissy. And then Sister Josette, then Sister Laura. We're not trying to, nobody trying to be right or wrong. I'm not saying you're wrong. It's just open discussion. Yes, Sister Chris.
My comment was just simple, that if he never went down to the juke joint and got with Cannon, none of this would have happened. So I put the blame back on him.
Okay, I understand that. Sister Josette.
The only thing that it just seems like, you know, I mean, I hear, I don't want to use the word premeditated, but she, I have to say, and the reason why I believe both was, is because both has to be accountable to what they're doing. Yes, I understand that that he did not fulfill his obligation. And she was at a crossroad, really. She really had to do something because, first of all, she was a widower and she had no children. So right. Life wasn't going to be really nice for her in the end if she didn't have one. But the idea that she knew he was coming down there, and how did she know that she needed to position herself in that way? Because if she did not know that he had a habit or heard that he had done something previous like that, then she would have never positioned herself like that. So she knew exactly that he was going to go and in his, you know how they go, we go shopping and then you stop at the store to pick up something. Well, he was going to stop to do whatever he's done. Okay. And that's why she positioned herself that way. Because if she didn't know, if there was some instance,
okay, let's Sister Laura, I'm sorry.
I understand that she set him up for the okie doke, but he didn't have to fall for it. He fell away from who he was. He walked away from who he was to go down to the juke joint and then to go on in to do what he was doing. He did it.
I understand, Chuck and Captain.
Okay, well, first of all, I mean, we have to control ourselves.
Thank you.
We have to be in myself every day. I see women all over the world, and that don't mean I have to get with them all.
Come on.
I've got one that gives me enough problems already. But, no, I'm just saying.
No, you're in trouble, Charles.
We have to get we can't say anything and do anything that even if the thought pops up in his head, he needs to shut that down and do what
he wants to do. Absolutely. Pastor Dave, again, we need, you know, I'm welcoming these comments and I want to keep on because this is for discussion. This is not that anybody, so everything that you say pertains to this. It's acceptable. Yes, Pastor Davis.
I made mine quick. I agree with everybody, and especially just coming on what Josette said. She took my words and Chuck. Right. We know the Bible works. And unfortunately, his daughter-in-law knew, I mean, she knew her father-in-law. Unfortunately, he was known by his works. This wasn't the first time he's done this. Yes. So she knew what kind of man he was. She's probably seen him do this before. You know, he knew better. I mean, he's the fault. He didn't keep, number one, he didn't keep his promise. So he was a liar. She
right.
He was a liar. He's not a man to keep his promise. She didn't trust him.
Because his son is strong now.
And he went frolicking before. And she knew this. So she put her way in the way that she knew what he was going to do. And that's the problem. So to me, I would just say the blame on him. You know, that sins of the fathers again, he knew better. He should have been a man of his word, been known by his words. We should never, and that's why we have to be right as Christians, because we cause other people to have to position themselves out of order just to do the right. We shouldn't have to do that. We can call other people to compromise.
Right.
We should never do that. So, you know, he shouldn't have done that.
Okay, so babe, if you can summarize it, may I go across?
Okay, I just wanted to say, I'm just going to go back further than that in Genesis. I'm going to go back to the garden. When the Most High came down and talked to Adam, he didn't ask for Eve. He asked for Adam. He said, Adam, where are thou? And what did Adam say? And everybody know what he said. He said, is that what? Woman you gave me. So to me, I see this as all I know is the word, and that's true. The blame game went to the woman, you know, of course, here. But I blame Judah. Because I agree with Pastor Dave and what he just said. It's to me, it was Judah, because everything gonna start from that head.
Okay, so is Catherine, your hand still up for that residue?
Yes, I'm still here. Okay. But I like to say, where am I?
We're still trying to, we're discussing question two. Who is to blame for this interaction? Still with
Hello?
Us?
You muted, Sister Cat.
Yeah, you're muted.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, what I wanted to say, I lined myself up with Joseph. Well, what I really want to say, this was a Canaanite sheep shearing festival. He knew what was happening down there. They worshiped, and then they had the women. He knew what he was doing. He messed up way back in when he married outside his faith. Oh, let me stop. So therefore, he was guilty. It was both of them. She set him up, but he fell for it because he knew he was going to go down there. He was going to enter somebody.
Okay, we're going to get Elder John the final word on it, and I'm appreciating this.
Well, Sister Catherine just said that in the first verse, Judah never set a standard. He lowered his standards from the first verse when he went out to marry the Canaanite. Therefore, and then his daughter-in-law, honestly, if she was not on the road, he would have had no reason to stop because he could have just walked on home. But because she has set herself up in a position, and like the song say, I want her. He had to go. He had to go that route, you know? So I'm just going to say it's both of their faults. It's both faults. That's what I'm going
to
say.
Yeah, this is enlightening. They both contribute to the interaction happening, but just entertain this for thought. We're talking about the enemy's playbook, and when you're talking about blame, because there's no answer, there's no key to these questions. They're just for discussion, and I'm not agreeing or disagreeing with anybody. I'm not going to say my answer is right. I just will submit this for the group to consider. Let's go back to verse 14 and read when this event started. What it caused, as Sister Lauren said, it was what I forgot the word she said. That what she said, was
premeditated.
Premeditated. Okay, I can't disagree with that. But let's listen. Let's read this verse 14 real carefully. So she took off her widow's garment, covered herself with a veil, wrapped herself, and sat in an open place, which was on the way to Timnah, for she saw. Now, this is explaining why she did what she did. So a lot of times when we're dealing with people, we have to like look at what they did. But, you know, the another key factor is let's try to identify why she did this. But she saw that Shelah was grown. Now, we can go back to what Judah promised her, come and live as a widow, and here when my son is grown, I will give him to you. For the son is grown, and she was not given to him as a wife. Let's just meditate on that. So he broke her promise. He broke his promise to her. She took drastic actions. Yeah. I'm not saying she was right. Yeah. But when you talk about placing blame, if you're going to sit, you know, to a degree of judgment, not to judge them, but try to evaluate something, this is just a premise that I am suggesting and what my reasoning is. There's always a cause and effect. She behaved in a very ungodly way.
Mm-hmm.
He lied to her and did not keep his word. And then having a husband was an economic decision too. I mean, just food for thought. Because sometimes we can look, well, they did this. Well, why? Oh, I don't know why she did it. She all dressed up like a hoochie mama out there. She know that's all wrong. But wait, the guy done lied to her. And in a way, right, it took both of them for these events to occur. I can agree with that. I can understand that. But when we start using this principle, how did this get, because we can go back to, I think, Eva and Dave and others maybe went all the way back to the fact the first time he went creeping down there, that started all these bad events in motion. Mm-hmm. Straight away from God. So we got to understand that, like the analogy of the bullet and the metal line sign, sights on a rifle. See, he went down there before, and I ain't going to be like, Bo John, he went back again. Oh, well, I got away with it once. I'm going to get away with it again. Because she knew, not, she didn't know, how'd she know where to go? How'd she know how to approach him? She knew that he was subject to this. Mm-hmm. He had the spirit of this. He's done me wrong, and I know how to get him back.
Mm-hmm.
Iman, or Tina, I see your hand.
Yeah, just meet, and just real quick, I would just cut Judah a little slack only because the only reason I cut him some slack is because of he was a widower, and yep. So he did lose his wife, and I can't look over that, because had she still been around, or maybe if he had taken a second wife, I know it's hypothetical, but in that weakened state of grief, even though the time of mourning had passed, you know, she did. He was taken advantage of in that state. So I'm not excusing what he did, but I believe it did play a part because he did lose his wife.
In 12.
I'm just saying, I'm not going to look over that. I got to look at the whole picture. Yeah, I ain't going to hold Judah under the bus. That's all.
Daughter Shula, Judah's wife did die, and he was comforting when it was, right. So I do understand that. And again, we understand circumstances do things, but okay. I can understand that perspective.
Pastor Ed.
Yes.
Can I ask this question? And that it's pertaining, because I thought the same thing too, like Imam was talking. Well, he was a widower, you know, just like she was. Just like she was, he was one too. And the question I was gonna ask is, was it common that, you know, if men had lost their wives, that it was okay for them to go out and, you know, and find them someone on the side, you know, to fulfill a need or whatever? Was it something common that these men did? So, I mean, you know, because when you try to put it all together, and it's like what Imam was saying, you know, cut them some slack. Okay, so we know that. Because if you look at 13, somebody says it was told to her that he was on his way down there. So that's as though, you know, it could have been something, you know. But well, anyway, that's right. Just a question I wanted to ask.
Right. As Sister Catherine pointed out, they knew the type of activities that were there that would go on and know that he would be, you know, as I think Elder John, I see him not that he would be vulnerable at this time. So yeah, we could, you know, acknowledge that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying that, oh, well, he was all jacked up. Mm-hmm. But by the same token, I want to go back again to the earliest event, you know, not to go all the way back to him disobeying God. What set this into motion? And this is just for discussion, not to try to win a point. You understand? He told her something that was important to her. Because I understand, I look at it from this perspective, in spite of what Judah, I'm not saying Judah was a slime ball and need to go to hell. I'm not him. I'm merely trying to evaluate the circumstances when we talk about how we conduct ourselves. We start to analyze things, how to get the situation. But I think as believers, sometimes we end up in situations of animosity and nobody really sat down to see how this madness started. Because sometimes I've talked to people in other places and it's all kind of mad, crazy stuff going on. You didn't get to talk to them. Well, Dada, why are you doing that? Oh, well, so-and-so said you did this. Didn't do that. Yeah, they done been mad at you for like a half a year over something that never occurred. So let's look back again. And I do understand what you're saying. And the fact that he didn't have a wife didn't really commit him to that wifely relationship. But by the same token was he had made his daughter-in-law a promise. He had told her to come somewhere and he was going to do something. Because I understand that's very important. Having no children was very important. Having that husband was very important to her. But he didn't fulfill his promise. That's the point I'm looking at. I'm not really trying to condemn Judah. But what led to that was she, if you read the rest of the story, we're going to pick up with it the next time. The fact that he didn't, you know, we're going to factor out the fact that he went to an ungodly woman, you know, but he did not keep his promise to her. So he placed her in a position somewhat of desperation. Now, I'm not saying she's right. I'm not agreeing with Tamar at all. I'm not saying what she did was right. All I'm saying is I can understand that she was in a situation where she felt she had to take drastic actions, and she had to take those drastic actions because from reading the rest of the story, unfortunately, we don't have time to look at the night. She had a plan in mind because all we had to do is look at what she wanted from him. If you haven't read it, I'll read it now because we're going to have to run out of recording time. Look at what she required from him for what she for their interactions. She set him up.
Yep.
He set him up. But I'm not saying, but see, he put himself in a position to be set up. So what does that really mean? What's the point that I'm trying to make out of this? We have to understand when Satan comes at us, he kind of like the Bill Belichick. You know, for those of you know about football, he's going to come up with some plans. We think, oh, he's going to come right straight. I'm going to be able to figure out Satan in a few seconds. Oh, no, he got multiple options. And he has patience. He will work in sequence. And if I don't get you here, I'm running an option play. That's all he runs is option plays on us. He comes at us with different options over and over. And I see the hands. We're going to discuss those before we leave. Over and over again. So, you know, blame maybe, you know, actually the way the question is you know, it's really for discussion. Because I'm not here trying to place blame on either one. Because look at, you know, if we're really going to be analytical, they both were wrong. I'm not saying one was right and one was wrong. They both were wrong. But I'm still thinking Judah's actions was more of a catalyst than Tamar's action, in my view. I'm not trying to be right, but yeah. So either way you answer it was fine for me. If those of you like me, you know, nobody's, you know, this intends to be right. We want the right answer to this. The right answer to this is don't get away from God's will that they won't have to worry about the ramifications of what Satan going to do to us. I want to go back to Iman and Miss Alicia and anybody else before we close. And we'll continue this next week. This has been great.
Iman, I'm sorry. My hand wasn't up. I'm sorry.
Okay. Miss Alicia, your hand is still up.
I had a question. If those two were under judgment, who would have gotten stoned and why?
That's a good one.
That's an excellent question.
Ooh. Can I say something?
Yes, sure. Please, somebody help me.
Neither, because who would have threw the first stone?
What's that?
No,
you
didn't say that.
What you
say? I said neither, because who would have been worthy to throw the first stone?
Oh, yeah, this is pre-Christ.
Yeah,
that's pre-Christ. Mm-hmm. Can I just say something? The revelation that I'm getting. Oh, Sister Alicia, I'm sorry. Were you finished?
I'm finished, yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to say, even though Judah did wrong, went into this other kingdom, Canaanite, and chose a wife out of there,
I see the enemy moving in there, but can I, what I also see and discern how the Most High took it and turned it, because the Messiah had to come down that lineage through Judah, hallelujah. So that the enemy tried to use for evil, the Most High took it and turned it because he knew the way that the Messiah had to come. Even though both of them was wrong, the Most High still got the glory because the Messiah had to come. So I just wanted to say that when you look at things, even though it might be evil, the enemy is not more powerful than our God. Even though this was sin and this was pure evil, the way Judah did the woman, and even the woman seduced and trying to seduce Judah, it was wrong. But it all started with Judah disobeying his father.
Oh, okay. Yeah, you went a little further than we did. Can't disagree with that, because the Christ did come from that lineage of the tribe of Judah. That's undeniable. That's the truth. But just looking at this in a microcosm, sort of boiling back down, I mean, I'm in the minors, is we do understand that there's spirits of that we have to be aware of and things. And this could have been avoided if Judah just kept his word. Because the son was done what he said he was going to do, what he was supposed to do. And I don't know, maybe there's something in there that wasn't published. And but we'll look at the rest of it next, because it gets, you know, very, if you read the rest of it, it's very, very interesting on what went on and how Tamar really, really set him up. and do understand, because to me, the one thing, the principle I want, one of my grandfather, whatever we say, we need to do what we say. If not, we don't need to say it. We shouldn't make empty promises to anybody. Not just say stuff to say it, because it's going to carry ramifications. Guess what? Satan's going to be there. Because you see what he did. He put both of them in the trick bag, in my opinion. So if we really want to look at the ultimate person to blame, it would be Satan. Because he orchestrated and influenced both of them to act in ungodly ways. So any last questions or comments? We will finish the rest of this question 3 through 5 next week. And I appreciate tonight, because I learned a lot, and hopefully everybody else did. So we got to understand that Satan is not coming in a direct line. Matter of fact, I've said at times he's going to be involved, and sometimes we can be way into a situation before we take a moment and take a breath and evaluate what's going on, and like, this ain't right. We might be church folks, but this ain't right. Something has got to give. So I'm calling a timeout while we evaluate what we're talking about. I'm not going to say another word. Certain things that me personally, I'm not going to talk about this, not going to get involved with this. And that's me. I have to guard myself, because sometimes I will go into that spiritual sort of attack mode and say something that can cause offense and be misunderstood. So one thing I'm looking at, Judah shouldn't have made a promise that he wasn't going to keep. And he shouldn't have strayed outside of God's way, because you see what that bought with disaster, the two sons doing. One so evil, he just taken out. The second one just didn't act right. So I better stop. Because he just told her that, I ain't going to do it. Just poof, God, okay, poof, take you out. Instead of going through the motion. But they put the woman in a desperate situation. And I'm not blaming one or the other. But we have to understand that everything we do in the kingdom is serious, and it carries impact and repercussions and consequences beyond what we may be aware of. And we never want to be guilty of unknowingly causing harm to another person, you know, physically or spiritually, by, you know, not doing what's right. So, excuse me, Sister Lauren, you have anything before we close, dear?
So I just wanted to say, maybe Judah slept with her because he did not allow the last son to sleep with her. So he figured, well, being that the last one didn't sleep with her, I'll just go ahead and.
But you have to understand, he didn't know who she was.
He didn't know who she was.
He was close.
Until after the fact.
Yeah, he was suffering from that affliction that a lot of us men suffer through at times in our life. We think below our belt.
Okay. I was trying to give him the benefit.
No. He didn't know who she was.
That's what I'm talking about.
I'll stay back to my first comment, though.
Yeah, he was clueless as to who she was. We'll get into that next week. He had no idea who she was. No idea whatsoever. And yes, Sister Chrissy, that a comment, question?
Just a comment.
Yes, ma'am.
How much of the story was a display of the domino effect of sin.
Just, right.
Open up a crack and then just one sin after the next, it's just a domino effect of wickedness that happened just from his initial action and even causing him to stumble along the way. But I see now after the study, it's been a very beneficial study for me to see and use the study, you know, in ministry, just on that point.
Yes, that's well said, because it's right. It started with one thing and now you got two deaths and now got the father sleeping with his daughter-in-law and don't know who she is. And really, don't reduce this to just, unauthorized sex. It's much more than that going on. So we'll look at the rest of it next week. And you're right, there is always a domino effect. Because when you look at, keep talking about the enemy's playbook and that getting shift, the other thing to me right now is football. But see, when you're opposing somebody, if you can get them, if you're trying to get the advantage and you know that they have a position and they're trying to, they're occupying a position that you need to capitalize on or want to exploit, you got to deceive them to get just slightly out of position. See, it don't take a lot. See, Satan ain't got to like run over us and knock us down. All he got to do is get me to lean the wrong way, left or right, so he can take advantage of that weakness that he's helped create. And if you watch a lot of sports, you can see that. If you really look at it carefully, that's really what has happened. I think basketball, I play a lot of basketball. But really, if you really want to take advantage of a person, all you want to do, you want to go to the right, so you want to get this person to lean to his right, your left. And anybody that's played, I played with these guys here, son of my ex or that, that's what I fake. Okay, you went there, and that's what they ain't going to do. I'm showing you over here. Okay, I'm defending this. I'm not even going that way. I'm going over here. you thought you were coming out here to do this. I'm going to throw this woman at you, and you're not going to resist it, and all hell's going to break you tonight. So it is a domino effect. We got to understand that. Our position is we got to be careful not to lean spiritually to the left or the right, but to stand straight to the best of our ability. And we do lean left or right, recuperate, and stay straight spiritually as much as we can. All right. Thank you so much. I totally enjoyed this. And, not going to worry about time. God will take care of that, too. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Father God, for your illumination of your word. We thank you, Father God, for the spirited discussion, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, for what you imparted to us this day, that we, Father, may be sharpened, more concise, better, Father God, and more effective in your kingdom right now, Father God, that we won't be susceptible to the tricks of the enemy. And Father God, if we do, let us be united, Father God, and protect one another, Father God. So where one is weak, the other is strong, Father God. One doesn't know, the other will get the revelation. May we share you with each other, protect each other, love each other as you do, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I love you guys.
Hey, well, this was excellent, y'all. I enjoyed this.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Awesome. Hey,